You know, every time after I record one of these videos, it automatically, as it compiles, it starts playing and I can hear my voice and I can tell I'm not 100% my normal self. I've been a little sick over the past few days and it all started with me puking my guts out over and over again with the flu. And that reminded me of when I first got married. And the very first time I got sick after I got married, I got a huge migraine and felt like I needed to throw up. And my dad, who was in the Navy, gave a great tip for when you need to throw up. He said, "What you do is you drink a bunch of cool water." And that does two things. First of all, it makes it so there's more liquid in there, so it's not quite so bad coming back out. And then if it's nice cool water, it's kind of refreshing as you throw up your guts out. So anyway, so I was feeling like I was going to throw up, and I decided that I needed to run in and drink a bunch of cold water. So I went in and to the sink, and I got a big cup full of cold water, and I drank it, and that immediately triggered me needing to throw up. And the only place that was there was the sink. So I threw up, puking my guts out, and my wife's sitting in the other room watching TV. And it's just a very unpleasant thing, right? And so it was very unpleasant as normal, and unpleasant sounds, and not fun at all. And I get done, and then I'm kind of waiting for, this is the first time since this has happened since I've been married. I'm waiting for some sympathy and some nice words from my wife. "Oh, are you okay?" Or something to that effect. And what I got was from the other room, I heard this: "You threw up in the sink? You couldn't have made it to the toilet?" That's what I got. That's my life, my sympathy that I get from my beautiful wife. So, anyway, where we left off. So where I was going with that, I'm not my normal self. Hopefully this is okay. Where we left off was we got two games, and I forgot to save this, so I'm going to save it real quick. But we've got Spencer's Dumb Game that is one part of this Monopoly code that I wrote initially. And then we went and wrote this separate dice element to simulate the roll of the die. And then now I'm writing this other, or have written this other part about Spencer's dumb game that's actually going to play the game, right? But the part we're missing is rolling the die. So I've built this class that all it does is has a roll dice method that I can call, and it will return to me the simulation of the roll of the dice, right? Or an individual die. I guess I should say roll die, shouldn't I? Because it's just doing one for now. Okay, but that's what this class does. So now how do I create an instance of that? Well, it's just like I do with the scanner or anything else. I say I want to create an instance of the dice class. And I can call it whatever I want to. I can just call it D, kind of like we've done with the random R. But I can just call it D and say that's a new instance of the dice class. So this part defines it again, this part instantiates it. And now I have the dice class built. Once I've done that, then I'm able to access those methods. So what I can do is this. I can say in this particular game, set die one equal to, now can I just call the roll die method? So can I say roll die now? So set it equal to roll die. If I do this, it's going to yell at me and say, "I cannot find that symbol. I have no idea what that means." Well, that's because this method doesn't have a roll die method, right? That method belongs to the dice class, and I can't actually access the method in the dice class. I can only access the instance of the method that's created. Now remember, this is like the mold. This is the instructions on how to create it. This is the actual created element that is an instance of that object. The example that I always like to use is the Clone Wars, right? In the Clone Wars, they take Jango Fett and they clone him many, 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 many times, right? Because he's this great warrior. They take Jango Fett and clone him. Each cloned individual is their own individual. They have their own thoughts and their own actions and their own. They look like Jango Fett, but they're their own self, right? They're all based on that model. We've set up the template here with the Dice class, and all we're doing now is just saying, let's create an instance of that class. I want one. Give me a Dice class. I'm going to call it D. If I wanted to, I could call it Django. I can call it Bob. I can call it whatever I want to, but it's my instance of the object. What happens when this occurs is that in memory, an instance of that object is created, okay? And this instance of the object in memory, and I forgot to draw memory, but I've written this kind of big so that I can say, this is a dice, it's called D, so this is referred to as D. And one of the methods that's inside this D is the roll die method. So it has a roll die method. Those are parentheses. Okay, I could then go in and just create another instance if I wanted to create another one for some reason. I could call this one from the dice class, I could call it D2 and set it equal to a new dice instance. And it would create another object in memory called D2. And it would also have a roll die method. The two would be identical. But even though they're identical, they exist as two separate objects in memory. And this is the same thing that's been happening whenever we create a scanner, or whenever we create a roll, a random, or anything like that. This is the same thing that's been happening. There's an object out here from the random class, and it has all the methods and properties that are available with it. Same thing with the scanner. But the point is, this roll die method belongs to what? Well, it belongs to the D method. And so I'll get rid of this. So when I call the roll die method, I have to say D dot roll die because that's who the method belongs to, right? And then I can do the same thing for die 2, D dot roll die. Okay, I'm going to get a total from that, and I can say total equals die 1. Plus die 2, and then now my game runs. I just plugged in this code along with this instantiation of that line, and now in theory this should run. Okay, there we go. We've got the same thing happening. We've rolled 120, 92 wins, 808 losses, 221 wins, 779 losses. This program functions. I've just taken these two parts of the program and put them together. And what have I just accomplished? Well, what were we shooting for here? We now have split up the program in the way that two people could work on it at the same time. This individual handles the dice rolling with the random number. This individual got kind of the raw end of the deal in this situation, but they handled all the gameplay. This is more lines of code. But, you know, the idea is let's go and you here's what I'm expecting of you. You're going to pass me a number. I'm going to call your class. You're going to pass me back a number that represents the role. Okay? You go work on that in your cubicle. I'm going to go to my cubicle and I'm going to work on this gameplay. In fact, you know, maybe it's, I don't even, you don't even need to, don't ask me what I'm going to do with your dice roll program. Just go create it. If this is a mean boss, just go create your program. It doesn't matter. Just go create a program that passes back a number, an integer, that represents the number of a dice roll, and I'm going to do my thing with it. The two programs then come together to form this one program. I mean, isn't this a, I mean, this is a really simple concept. Again, the only thing is if you don't understand the why, meaning, you know, this ability to work in teams, if I were just to tell you to write a program this way and split it up into two, which is what a lot of people who are teaching object-oriented programming do. Here, do it in two parts. Well, why don't I just do it in one part? No, two parts is better. Well, why is it better? It takes longer. That's true, but do it that way. Well, this is more lines of code. Yeah, that's true too. Just do it that way. Just do what I say. That kind of thing is annoying, right? So hopefully you're understanding why it's beneficial to do it this way. Now we can do it in two parts, right? This is that space element. And we could even expand on this. We could make it so that this dice part picks up more of the functionality of the program, that you could pass it a certain number of dice. And then we could get the roles and let's see, I'm trying to decide if we can do this quickly enough. And I think we probably can. We could expand this to say, you know what? I'll tell you what, I'll call it the roll dice program, and what you'll pass me is an integer that will represent the number of dice that you want to roll. Right? You get what I'm saying? So they're going to pass in a number of dice, and then we're going to give them a total from that number of dice. That's still going to be an int that we're going to pass back. And so now, how can I do that? Well, I can just create a rolling total, right? Okay. And then instead of doing it the way I've done it, I could say for an int I equals 1, well, I is less than or equal to the number of dice, so however many dice they want to pass in, that's fine. Then I will take and add to the total whatever the total was plus the roll of the die. So I can say r.next int out of 6 plus 1. I'll put that in parentheses even though I don't need to because I like to try and keep things organized. Okay, so that's I'm going to take and add to the total. Now total starts out at 0. And then I'm going to add to it for the number of dice that they pass in that many rolls. So if they pass in 2, it'll do this twice and it will add to the total the simulated roll of the dice, right? And then pass back the roll. Well, now I've just offloaded some of the work of that other program. And I could say instead of creating all this thing with die 1, die 2, I could just do a total. And then I can get rid of rolling those dice that way. And instead, I can say I want total to be equal to d dot roll dice, and the number of dice that I want to roll is how many? Well, I want to roll 2 dice, and I want to get a total back from that. Does that make sense what I've done? Well, now we've even offloaded a little bit more code, right, to that other class. And that's kind of a beneficial thing. Oh, we can't return the roll anymore because now what we've got is a total, so I need to return the total. Roll doesn't exist anymore in this method. Okay, so I got to compile this one first so that the other one can recognize it. And then now I come back here and say, do this, compile it and run it. And the program still works great, amazingly enough. Okay. But I've done this now in an object-oriented manner. I've got two classes working together to accomplish the same task. And this is, again, this is this idea of space, multiple people being able to work on the same program. So what we'll talk about next is time. Okay? Spencer puking.